Okay, good. How are you all? It's nice to see you. So only the stalwarts are left at this time of the year. Miami in May is a desert town, which reminds me of a short anecdote that my daughter Eliza Shoshana just mentioned to me, and I'll relay to you. So the joke goes that in Scotland, they have an annual festival to celebrate the art of the lumberjack, you know, where they throw the huge poles and things like that. And so they have this competition one year, and they have a Scotsman comes up first, and the first competition is to see who can fell the largest tree. And the Scotsman comes up, his muscles bulging, and you know, with his kilt flying, he swings this mighty axe, and with two blows, he knocks over this massive tree. And then they have a Quebecois guy comes from France, from Quebec, and you know, he walks up, and his biceps are tearing out his plaid shirt, and he swings his axe three times, massive tree falls down. Finally, they get this little old Jewish guy from Brooklyn. And he just kind of makes his way up there, sort of holding his back a little bit, and he picks up this axe, which is very difficult for him. He actually picks up one of the smallest axes, and it's still very difficult. And they say, wait a minute, are you sure that you can do this? And he says, yes, I'm sure. And so they say, all right, have at it. Picks up the axe, and without even, you know, breathing hard, one swipe, and he knocks over the biggest tree in the forest. They're all amazed, and they go up to him, and they say, you know, that was phenomenal. That was amazing. How did you do that? He says, well, you ever hear of the Sahara Forest? And they say, what? The Sahara Desert. And he says, now it's a desert. Okay, maybe I didn't tell it so well, but anyways. Okay, thank you. I appreciate it. All right. Tonight's topic is a fascinating one. I'm afraid that's probably the last laugh we're going to have, because it's a very dark topic, really. It deals with the Holocaust, and obviously that's a period of great pain and suffering for the Jewish people as a whole, not to mention many other peoples in Europe in particular, and many Americans in uniform who went over to fight and to die in European and in North African battlegrounds, Pacific battlegrounds. But we're going to focus on one really amazing individual, the Piaseczno Rebbe, also known as the Esh Kodesh, after his most famous work, a collection of sermons that were discovered in the rubble of the Warsaw Ghetto, also known as the Rebbe of the Warsaw Ghetto, for his heroic decision to stay with the embattled Jews in that tremendously horrible environment of the Warsaw under the Nazi occupation. And as a result of some historical accidents, we have a record of his activities during those terrible years, and they give us tremendous historical insight into the nature of Jewish community under such tremendous trauma. So before I go into his life in general, I just have one little plug that I promised my son I would do. Here we go. My son Alexander, he's 15 years old, and he hopes to go to Israel this year on an NCSY program called Built Boys Israel Leadership Training. And we're really hoping that, you know, the boy, he's definitely got down. The Israel, that's a destination. The leadership, that would be fantastic if he can get some of that and training. So he's in this, doing this learn-a-thon here. Outside, you'll see there's little forms. If you want, you can tear something off, and you can sponsor him to manage the tuition for this huge event. We're really grateful that some of you have already, Bev, thank you very much for sponsoring him already. Please go visit the website and think about getting him out of the house for 5 weeks and hopefully learning something really valuable in Israel, working with victims of terror and training on IDF bases and things like that. Okay, that's the plug. Let's go straight to the material today. So the claim to fame of the, here's one of the very few pictures that exists of the Piaseczno Rebbe. His name is Rabbi Kalonymus Kalmish Shapiro. The name itself says something about who he is. First of all, he was named after an illustrious grandfather who was named Kalonymus Kalman, and was the author of one of the greatest Hasidic works of the 19th century, the Maor Vashemesh. In order not to seem you know, arrogant, he never referred to himself by his proper name, Kalonymus Kalman. He used the diminutive Kalmish to distinguish himself from his famous grandfather. He was nevertheless a scion of a very important Hasidic dynasty, and he lived at the tumultuous beginning of the 20th century and was martyred in the Holocaust, not in the Warsaw death camp, the Warsaw ghetto itself, but in a related labor camp called Travniki, as we shall discuss shortly. He was famous before the war began, particularly for his educational theories and a remarkable book he wrote called Chovos HaTalmidim, The Obligation of Students, which we will talk about this evening. But clearly his claim to fame in the second half of the 20th century is this amazing and absolutely unique work that he wrote in the Holocaust itself. So let's go into his life and work and try to understand a little bit about who he was and how he contributed to the Jewish world and to the body of Hasidic literature in a very unusual way. So as I mentioned, comes from a very famous grandfather, the Maor Vashemesh. He's related on several sides, several ways to many Hasidic dynasties. As a child, he lost his father when he was very young, an infant really, 3 years old. He was raised by his grandfather and groomed really for leadership of his small Hasidic group. This loss of his father at a very, very tender age was a psychological element that is visible as a theme throughout his works. There's a thread of loss of the authoritative figure, a yearning for that father figure that you can see in most of his commentaries, and he wrote quite extensively during the 20s through the early 40s. At 18 years of age, his Hasidim decided to name him the Rebbe, a very, very young age really to take on that mantle leadership, but he was clearly quite worthy of it, and he ended up setting up a yeshiva in Warsaw itself, a major city. And I'm not sure, you know, how much of this is what they say in Hebrew, guzma, or exaggeration, but apparently the entrance exam to this yeshiva called Torat Moshe, if I remember correctly, was the memorization of 50 blot of Gemara. To know 50 folio, that is 100 pages of Talmud by heart, completely incredible achievement, but that is apparently what they say about his yeshiva in Warsaw. Very well regarded. He was married at a relatively young age. He had a smallish family with one son and two daughters. His wife unfortunately passed away in 1938, and all of his children were killed in the Holocaust, as we shall describe shortly. He survived them all and continued to write about them and their memories long after. So his first major achievement, the signal achievement of the 1930s that placed him on the map of Jewish intellectuals of the era, was this remarkable book called Chovas HaTalmidim, Chovat HaTalmidim, The Obligation of Students. It is a truly unique work, and it is essentially how to be a 12-year-old. It's a book on childhood for children written in the 1930s. It's clear that he was fairly well read in psychological literature of the day, particularly in German, and he quotes and paraphrases it with some frequency, but it is undeniably a work of Hasidic thought. Basically, it is the first volume in a multi-volume series that he authored. Only one of which was published before the war, another was published privately, I'll talk to you about it in a second, and two others were discovered after the war. But he basically wrote this book on how to be a 12-year-old, and then later he wrote a book called Hachsharsa Avrechim, which is more or less how to be an 18-year-old, one more volume, which is really about how to be a 25-year-old, and it's basically defining stages of childhood, adolescence, and then this category of emerging adulthood, and he attempted through these books to really guide people on the road to maturity for the sake of Jewish leadership. And I'll explore those concepts shortly. It is a truly brilliant work. It begins with an introduction that's written for parents and teachers, which is very valuable. It's on what is the meaning of education in Jewish philosophy. And then he speaks directly to the 12-year-old, although in a very unusual way. The first thing he does in Chovas HaTalmidim is he writes about how don't be afraid of Judaism. You're not going to have to give up being a kid. You love playing ball, you love running in the streets with your friends, all that is okay. Don't look at, you know, the rabbis sitting and studying and say, oh my gosh, that looks so dull. Don't worry, you will get to that stage where it will seem as fun as playing ball. Just enjoy your ball right now, but while you're playing, remember that you have these other obligations. Hence, chovas ha-talmidim, the obligations of students. He says, first of all, you have to develop, to a 12-year-old, a certain level of self-knowledge. You have to know your own strengths and your weaknesses. And do not recognize your weaknesses as flaws that must be, you know, eliminated. Recognize them as core elements of your personality that must be harnessed. And he argues that there's no such thing as a bad mida, a bad character trait. It's just a character trait that has to be directed properly. To give you an example, he says, let's say you are a very obstinate person, an akshan. You're very argumentative and difficult and so on. He says, you know, you may find that that gets you into a lot of arguments and people may not find you so pleasant and so on. But in reality, that is a tremendous skill for a leader because it means a leader who has that capability can be courageous under criticism, can withstand various challenges in order to remain focused on a single goal. That's actually a very admirable characteristic. And he goes through a whole list of characteristics and says that all of these things are truly very valuable for you. And furthermore, he says, you might be overwhelmed with the task. You may say, oh my gosh, my mother is always cocking me a china. She's always giving me a hard time over this behavior or that behavior. How am I ever going to change? He says, don't worry, you will be able to control these characteristics. And he says, for example, who taught you how to sleep in a bed without falling off at night? Even when you're unconscious, you know, when you were a child, they had to put bars up or give you a crib so you wouldn't fall out of bed. But as you grew older, even in your sleep, you could control your movement and make sure you stay on the bed at night. So he says, if you can do that, you can certainly learn these other ideas. It's really beautiful and motivating and a very powerful work. So much so that it became an instant classic. It was published and republished many, many times. Although a couple of interesting requests to publish it were denied. And that's specifically relating to what he put at the very end of the book, which is really a fascinating insight into what he planned for the rest of the series. This, by the way, is one of many images I'm going to show you today from the phenomenal American photographer Roman Vishniak. His visit to Poland in the 1930s, I think it was the late 30s, 1937 or 38, recorded the state of Jewish life just before the Holocaust for generations, and his very expressive sensibility, his understanding of you know, light and texture and personality really comes through in these photographs. I hope you enjoy them. I chose a lot for this slide. At any rate, at the end of Chovas HaTalmidim are three essays called Shlosha Ma'amarim, which are just straightforward Kabbalah. They're all about Jewish mysticism. And they seemed so discordant in a book about 12-year-olds. How could you include things which are considered really, you know, reserved for people of great learning? How can you put them in a children's book? And he was criticized for this, and several publishing houses asked him, please, can we print a version of your children's book, but without those three adult essays at the back? And he refused. They were an integral part of the work because he had to convince students that there is going to be a massive world of ideas ahead of them. The kind of things that he explores, particularly in these three essays, are his mystical, technique of using visions, his technique of attempting to visualize certain things in order to make the experience more powerful. So, for example, he has very evocative descriptions of what it must have been like to be a slave in Egypt, or what it must have been like to serve in the temple itself. Very dramatic and flowery language and very powerful emotive scenes. And this is part of his whole theory of trying to create a visual image of the meaning of the various mitzvot so that people would be more inspired by them. But at any rate, this book became a huge popular seller, and it has been translated into English no less than twice, and it is a staple in many Hasidic school systems to this day. Okay, I saw a question over there. Ms. Aliza Abramson.
Yeah, two things. If it is so popular, why isn't it incorporated into the curriculum for non-Hasidic schools as well? I mean, it sounds like it would be useful in any of the circles.
Well, I think I answered that question, didn't I?
Yeah, but even with the Kabbalah, you can teach students things without you can teach certain things without having an entire book in. And plus, if you're in a school system, the likelihood of actually finishing your curriculum is very low.
Well, that's a different issue about finishing the curriculum. But the first issue is, yeah, really, is because of the Kabbalah in the back of it. In fact, we have at home an English translation. There's two big ones, Simcha or Mika Odenheimer, very beautiful literate translation published by Aronson, and another translation published by Art Scroll, which is a very beautiful Hebrew-English edition. The Art Scroll edition, however, whenever it gets to those Kabbalistic passages, it tends to kind of fudge the translation and say, like in brackets, what follows is a little bit too technical for most of the material, and so the English translation is not true to the Hebrew at all, and you know, not unapologetically. But that's really one of the reasons that it never really took off outside of the Hasidic circles. Yes?
Number one, did Vishniak manage to photograph him?
No, unfortunately not.
And approximately what age was he when he wrote the book?
Well, let's see, he was born in 1889, and this was published in 32, so that would make him, about 40 years old. He died, I think, at 54. Okay, I'm going to go on. I'm going to ignore you for now, okay? Is it a follow-up to your previous question, or
it was the second question that I had.
Oh, so I cut you off. Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay, so you said that he mentioned psychology in it.
Yeah.
How consistent is his psychology in his work to modern psychology?
In order to answer that question, I'd have to know something about psychology, which I don't especially. My feeling is he read a lot of pop psychology. I don't think he read Freud in the original. I don't think he read the entire Interpretation of Dreams or anything like that. I think he read, you know, like digested versions that were easily accessible. You know, but this is definitely a Hasidic work, not so much a psychological work. I know you're going to read it as soon as we get home. Okay. Now, this gives you an idea about what else he's doing at the same time. Also in 1932, he privately circulated a little pamphlet, a remarkable little pamphlet called B'nei Machshava Tova, which means people of good thought. And unlike the Chovas HaTalmidim, which was designed for 12-year-olds, this was designed for his elite students only. And in this small book of less than 100 pages, he outlines a manifesto for nothing less than changing the entire Jewish world. He argues in B'nei Machshava Tova, ideas which are evident in some of the other works that eventually were published after the war, that the Jewish world had become desiccated and reified by externalities. He said that what's happening in Poland today, it sounds very familiar in many ways to, I think, our situation, people are very caught up in, you know, costumes and who's with one ideology and who's with another ideology, and everyone's like really sticking to one particular point of view and fighting with others without really thinking about what is at the heart of the matter, what is at the heart of Judaism and what unites us rather than what divides us. He says that, you know, he blamed this, by the way, on the failure of teachers to effectively communicate the warmth and the power of Judaism to the generation of youth. He said that no wonder that, you know, our youth are fleeing traditional Judaism for political movements like Zionism and communism. They're emigrating to America. They're doing all kinds of things except staying in yeshiva and studying intensely. And that's because we have failed, he says, in inspiring these youth. So he wrote this little book called B'nei Machshava Tova, which was really designed for his elite top students to transform the Jews of Poland in particular through the creation of small cells of highly supercharged, motivated Jews, sort of like Hasidic Jesuits, if you will, who will go out to the various far-flung corners of Europe. Really, in this way, he anticipated the Shlichut movement of the Lubavitcher Rebbe, who didn't start doing this until, I think, the late 50s or early 60s, sending out, you know, Jews to far-flung corners of the globe. But the Piaseczno Rebbe imagined like small groups of perhaps four or five Jews going out there, where they would meet regularly, and they would practice various meditative techniques, in particular one that he called hashkata, which means silencing, which is a gradual silencing of the internal monologue that goes on in one's mind until one reaches a period, a moment of like complete silence where your brain is not even thinking. And he encouraged these people to go out there and then work with each other. Here's another Roman Vishniak picture. This is one of my favorites here. Where he encouraged these people to go out and teach ordinary Jews the tremendous power of Judaism. And he hoped that by avoiding labels and by perhaps being post-denominational, to use a modern term, he would be able to transform Poland. Unfortunately, he was never able to put this plan into effect because the war truncated his efforts. And the only reason that we know about this book is because several of his students survived with copies of this book, and even though it says explicitly on the inside that this book is not to be republished, they went and they asked the Gerer Rebbe, another major Hasidic rabbi, if under the circumstances it would be permissible, and in fact he agreed, and so the book was nevertheless published and made available to later thinkers. So you can see what he had in mind with B'nai Machshava Tova. So to try and sum up his pre-war work, we see that his public face is very much towards children's education, but his much larger plan is nothing less than really transforming the Jewish landscape as a whole. Now, as I mentioned, his efforts were truncated or were cut short by the Nazi occupation of 1939, which extended until 1944, when the ghetto was finally reconquered by the Red Army. And it's a very sad and horrible story that I'd like to go over just in a few minutes to give context to the most important achievement of the Piaseczno Rebbe's work, which is primarily those writings that he completed in the ghetto itself. War broke out in September 1st, 1939, when the Nazis began bombing Warsaw tremendously. The city was already home to several hundred thousand Jews, and in the bombing raids, many Jews from the surrounding shtetlach, oh, I should mention, by the way, Piaseczno, which is kind of hard to pronounce if you're not familiar with the Polish alphabet. Piaseczno is a small suburb of Warsaw, about 14 kilometers or about 10 miles distant from the city itself. He really, in many ways, could be called the Warsaw Rebbe, but that was kind of like a very grandiose title, and so therefore he preferred to be called simply the Piaseczno Rebbe, which is just like this very small town close to Warsaw itself. He divided his time between Piaseczno and Warsaw. They're, you know, not too far distant, even by horse and carriage, and he spent about half the year in Warsaw, just like many of you will spend half the year in Miami and head back up to New York. So he really could have been called the Warsaw Rebbe, but he preferred Piaseczno. Here's a photograph of the bombings. So the Jews from the surrounding shtetlach, many of them felt it would be ironically safer in the city under these circumstances, and so the Jewish population just bloomed during the early bombing months, and that turned out to be quite disastrous for those Jews who were attracted to Warsaw. The ghetto itself was a confused and difficult place for Jews and non-Jews during the initial months of the war, primarily because the Nazis did not seem to have a clear idea what exactly they were supposed to do with the Jews in these large urban environments. It took several months before the Nazis finally decided they wanted to build a wall around Warsaw, around the Jewish quarter. They did not build walls around all of the ghettos. In fact, most ghettos were unwalled and the Jews were kept in by social pressure, by non-Jews who would turn them over to the Nazis if they tried to escape and so on. But and the other difficulty was that if you look at the patterns of Jewish settlement in urban areas, Jews tend to be urbanized from the very beginnings of most major cities, and so they tend to occupy the downtown regions of most of these areas, places where there are ports, you know, by the river and things like that. And ironically, that means that since they're downtown, the earliest developed places, they tend to have large municipal buildings, hospitals, cathedrals, all kinds of buildings like this are also built in great proximity to Jewish neighborhoods. And so therefore the idea of simply, you know, you couldn't just draw a square line around the Jewish settlement and say, okay, fine, this is the ghetto. The actual map of the ghetto was a crazy helter-skelter kind of arrangement to keep in as many Jews and yet allow non-Jews access to the buildings that they valued very much. So when they finally got around to it, it was well into 1940 before they began sealing off the ghetto. This is a photograph from November of 1940, showing Jews involved in the construction of the walls themselves. Jews had to fund it, Jews had to man it, and so on, and they effectively sealed themselves off from the outside world. Following that, and particularly in the disastrous winter of 1941, the Jews were in Warsaw were subjected to a strategy known by many historians as the strategy of attrition, which is distinct from the strategy of production, which characterized other ghettos. In Warsaw, it seems that the Nazis had the idea that the best thing would be to simply starve the Jews out of existence. They were given a ration of food, 150 calories per person, which is completely ridiculous. In America, an average adult male needs something somewhere between 2,000 and 2,500 calories per day. 150 calories per day is absolutely ridiculous. So the Jews turned to all kinds of ingenious and illegal activities to smuggle food into the ghetto. Creating huge recycling industries to try and take whatever resources were in the ghetto and transform them into goods that could be sold on the Aryan side, that is the non-Jewish side. And it was primarily children who were responsible to carry the goods out of the ghetto through various holes and passageways and tunnels and things like that, and then bring food back into the ghetto. In fact, one observer, I think it was Emmanuel Ringelblum himself, if I remember correctly, we'll speak about him in a minute, he said that if there ever would be a monument created to the heroism of the Jews in the ghetto, it should be a statue of a small child, because it were the children who were really sustaining the majority of the population through their dangerous, illegal, and often fatal activities. Nevertheless, even the activities of the Jews in the recycling industries and selling whatever furs, jewels, things like that they would have left was not sufficient to feed them, and the Jews died of tremendous numbers of starvation and also of a related illness, typhus, a disease carried by lice that especially affects people who are weakened by malnutrition. As you can see in the photograph here, there's so many heart-wrenching photographs of people simply lying in the streets until they expired, and every morning the Chevra Kadisha would have to go through the streets and collect up bodies for mass burial. At its peak in the winter of 1941, the Chevra Kadisha records indicates that they were collecting 150 bodies a night off the streets of the Warsaw Ghetto, just to give you some sense of the scope. It's hard to imagine it. The greatest historian of the ghetto, Emmanuel Ringelblum, estimates that when the ghetto was at its most crowded, they had actually 14 people per square meter of residential space, which is incomprehensible. A square meter is about a square yard. To have 14 people standing in one square yard for sleeping space, it meant that the vast majority of people were living, you know, outside in stairways and hallways, things like that, and no wonder the death rate was so incredible. There was a this photograph here is taken from the uprising in 1943, but in many ways the ghetto was its fate was sealed already in the summer of 1942, because the Nazis at that time had moved from the strategy of Einsatzgruppen murders, which were these mobile killing squads moving through the small shtetlach of Europe, gathering up the Jews and shooting them and having them fall into ravines where they were buried. In the spring of 1942, they moved to the strategy of death camps. Six camps were created, and Jews were killed by poison gas known as Tiklun Bey. And each of the major urban centers where Jews had been collected in ghettos were emptied in massive aktionen, or massive operations which deported all the Jews from the ghettos to the death camps. The deportation from Warsaw began on the ninth day of the month of Av in 1942, and only a tiny, tiny minority of Jews remained after the deportation had concluded. Approximately 10-15% of Jews were left. It was only after the deportation, among those remaining stragglers, that the Jews finally attempt to resist the Nazis with their uprising, and it was a very heroic and powerful uprising that delayed the Nazis some 6 weeks, which was really quite amazing, but it was primarily a symbolic gesture rather than a meaningful military one. There was no way that the Jews could actually have any impact on the Nazi beast under such dire circumstances. Nevertheless, they did mount this very meaningful gesture which sent reverberations across the Allies and many other resistance movements who felt that, you know, if the Jews could be rebelling in the ghettos, that must mean that we can all rise up against the Nazis. Now, we actually have some footage from the Warsaw Ghetto, which was produced often by Nazis who would visit the ghetto when they were on furlough. When they were off duty, many of them went in, took many of the photographs you're seeing tonight, and they also even brought in their 8mm cameras, and we have some footage. So I have a short clip here that I can show you that it's in color. I believe it was colorized. I believe that they used computer technology to enhance the image. And it's just this is a picture of the deportation. And so here you can get a sense. It's a 2-minute video. Can you zoom in on that, Mr. Rodriguez? Get a little sense of, you know, seeing it in color makes it feel so much more real and so much less distant than the black and white treatments. I'm guessing these images were taken in the spring of 1941. I think perhaps more terrifying than the sight of these children begging in the streets is the fact that so many people can simply walk right past them, that it's an absolutely normal phenomenon for just to see people dying like that. You can see the Jewish policemen. Jews were also put in charge of policing themselves. Okay, so that gives you some sense of the scene in which the Piaseczno Rebbe was required to rise to his greatest achievements. So let's look at one of the most famous books that has emerged from the Holocaust. The title given to it by its publishers was Esh Kodesh, The Holy Fire. It's not clear exactly why this title was chosen. There seems to be an allusion in one of its sections to a concept of holy fire, but that was not the title that he used himself. He called his book Discourses on Torah from the Years of Wrath, the Years of Anger. So let's get a sense of the history of this remarkable book. First of all, it was discovered in 1952 by a Polish construction worker. They were clearing the rubble from the ghetto, and as they're digging up the rotted floorboards of an apartment building, he discovered some milk cans buried underneath. He opened up the top of one of these tin milk cans, and he found it was filled with Hebrew manuscripts. He turned them over to the Jewish Historical Society, where they lay dormant for another 10 years, until a researcher named Duvdevani, who was specifically looking for the writings of the Piaseczno Rebbe, went to the Jewish Historical Society and found them. He then had them microfilmed, brought to Israel, and they were published in the early 1960s. And there are several works. The motivation and the methodology of this cachement of the documents was no doubt the result of this man's work. This is Emanuel Ringelblum, the so-called historian of the Warsaw Ghetto. An amateur historian with significant high school training, but not really advanced academic training. Wait a minute, I take that back. I'm thinking of someone else. He actually did have quite advanced historical training. He mobilized the whole cadre of volunteer historians, demographers, to go out and record everything that happened in the Warsaw Ghetto. And he had a whole army of people, well, not an army, he had quite a few number of people who went out and took, you know, measurements of living spaces, took statistics on how much food was coming in, how many people were dying. It is a result of Ringelblum's organization of this attempt to record everything that we know that an underground medical hospital was operative in the Warsaw Ghetto. We know that there were several newspapers that were functioning. A circulating library, even a theater was active in the Warsaw Ghetto because he had people recording all of these details. He also had one person who was specifically tasked to recording the religious life of Jews in the Warsaw Ghetto, a man named Shimon Huberband. Neither of them survived the war, but thankfully their writings did, because they would meet regularly in a secret organization called Oneg Shabbat, and they would submit all of their writings, they would critique them and refine them, and then ultimately when it looked like the ghetto was going to be destroyed in the summer of 1942, they buried them all in these tin milk crates, and two of the three caches have been discovered to date, giving us tremendous insight into what happened actually in the ghetto. Here's a photograph of one of those milk crates. We don't use things like this anymore, so it's hard to imagine, but it's something about this high, and it had a twist-off lid, so it was fairly well sealed, and it could obviously withstand the pressure and the time of being buried for so long. So at the top of this cache of documents was several books written by the Piaseczno Rebbe. This is the title page that's written in the Rebbe's own hand in Yiddish, and it says at the beginning, you know, attention, anyone who finds these documents, please send them to my uncle who is in Tel Aviv, and let him keep them there for me until I come back for them. If I do not survive, then please let them be published. And in fact, that is what he did. There's also a heartfelt plea in there for his only surviving daughter, Rachel, who disappeared one night. We now know that she was taken off in one of the Aktion and later gassed in a concentration camp. But at the time of writing, this was written in January of 1943, the Rebbe did not know what was the fate of his youngest daughter. And so with this document and the entire cache, they were sent to Tel Aviv ultimately and published. The other two books that were in there, besides the one that we're going to spend time talking about, were the three books, excuse me, Hachshar Sa'avrechim, which is the book kind of like for 16-year-olds, and then there was Mavo Hasha'arim, which was the book for sort of 25-year-olds, and then there was his personal spiritual diary called Tzav Veziruz, which is all three of which I'm sorry, Tzav Aziruz has been translated. The other two have not yet been translated. Okay. Now, what about the Esh Kodesh itself? This is a fascinating document, completely unique. Nothing like it exists in any of the literature on the Holocaust. Specifically, what this is, it's a... Well, actually, before I tell you, maybe I'll pause for questions because I haven't paused for a while. Or you're all on the edge of your seats. You want to know what's in the book. Okay, go ahead. No hard questions, please.
About Emanuel Ringelblum, he wasn't collecting only about Warsaw. They were sending people around Poland. Before the deportations from Warsaw, there were deportations from Lublin. And they wanted to know where did the Jews go.
Really?
So they were sending people out. And my family's from Rubieszow. There's a woman who traveled from Rubieszow to Warsaw and also gave her testimony about what was happening in Rubieszow.
Fascinating.
I haven't been able to get a hold of it. There's been an article written about it, but you know, they were trying to find out what was going on around Poland. There was a woman who was later became a member of the Knesset, Chaika Grossman, who was able to, and Chava Folman, two women were traveling around Poland disguised as non-Jewish women collecting information. They would come back to Warsaw.
Wow.
And tell Emanuel Ringelblum what was going on.
That's amazing. I didn't know that. Yeah. Wow, fascinating.
No, he was very, very, very active, not just with what was going on in Warsaw.
Amazing, amazing. Okay, so now let me tell you about what is this book, Esh Kodesh, because it's very unique. Basically, it is the record of his weekly sermons that he would offer on Saturday afternoons at the third meal, the so-called Shalashudas Drushas. Basically, this is a time in the traditional, you know, unfolding of the Jewish week under the Orthodox custom that, you know, Friday night you have the special Kabbalat Shabbat service and you have a full meal at home, and then Saturday morning you have the morning services followed by typically a Kiddush where people sit around and talk, and then the most somber moment of the day is when typically only men come back to the synagogue, they pray the afternoon service, and then they sit down for a light meal, and there's usually kind of like a somber, dark tone to what is said at that time because the Sabbath is on its way out. Then they conclude by praying the evening service, and they go back to regular weekday activities. In the Warsaw Ghetto, the circumstances must have been completely, you know, incomprehensible to us because people are starving. They're certainly not sitting around for, you know, bread and herring and things like that. They're having very, very meager rations. But the anticipatory mood of wondering what will the Rebbe say, what will the Rebbe give us, how will the Rebbe give us the strength to be able to go into the difficult week that we have ahead of us, that's specifically the task that the Piaseczno Rebbe had every week. These sermons, right after Shabbat, he would write them down, and we get a sense of, you know, what it must have been like week to week in the Warsaw Ghetto. Now, that it's not so simple though, because, and this is why there's so few scholars who have really penetrated the depths of the Piaseczno Rebbe's work, is that at no time, this is just a few photographs from the ghetto, at no time did he ever mention the word Nazi or German at all. These are drushas which are completely written in the Hasidic biblical idiom. And if you didn't know that you were reading a book that was written in 1940, 41, 42, you would think that you're reading some typical, you know, 19th century Hasidic text on the weekly portion, but it seems to be dealing with depressing themes over and over again, dealing with the theme of suffering, dealing with the theme of redemption, dealing with the theme of, you know, anticipated redemption, or dealing with the theme of, you know, God's justice in the world. Why does he keep returning to these thoughts? The fact is, his audience is specifically asking for these kinds of answers. Why is God not here? Why do we not see the, you know, immediate redemption of the Jews from such tremendous suffering? And every week he has to come up with more answers and more tools, psychological and social and most importantly religious tools, to allow Jews to come to terms with the tremendum of their suffering. A phenomenally difficult task. We can only imagine what he was going through. And so what these these texts give us is a sort of metaphysical history of the Holocaust as they were experiencing it, in which the Rebbe tries to place it within the timeless context of the events of the Parsha, the events of the Torah itself. So, in other words, as Jews would be on that given Saturday reading about the story of Joseph in his captivity, so then the Rebbe would speak about Joseph's captivity, and you could hear between the lines he's talking about the Jews' captivity in Warsaw. There was a kind of a metaphysical concurrence between the events the Jews were directly experiencing and the timeless history of the Bible itself. And it's very clear that he was evoking a parallelism between how the Jews had experienced the things in the distant biblical past and how this could be a lesson for them in the current day. This is based on a very deep Talmudic teaching of Masi Avos Simon Lamanim, that what happens to the ancestors is a sign for the descendants, meaning that, you know, we can find communion with our suffering in that of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob and so on. And quite often these things are really quite powerful and really overwhelming in their meaning. However, to really understand them properly, you need to do two things, which most researchers have only limited tools to do so. One is you have to understand the biblical text in its Talmudic and Kabbalistic context, which is in itself a whole field of inquiry. And the second thing is you have to know the actual history of quotidian life in the Warsaw Ghetto to know what happened in the ghetto that week that he would be speaking about this topic. And when you study the Esh Kodesh alongside the extensive journal and diary literature that we have, we see that he's often making very direct connections between, you know, a particular murder that the Nazis committed or an atrocity that happened somewhere and that the Jews are looking for an answer, and he places that answer within his Saturday afternoon drasha. Very profound and difficult way to convey a comfort to his audience, but nevertheless, it was done in a very poetic and powerful manner. We know from Shimon Huberband, one of the associates of the Oneg Shabbat archive, that he was gathering some 300 people a week to his Shalosh Shuras Drushas, even when the Nazis had forbade Jews from gathering publicly for religious purposes, meaning that Jews were flocking to him to hear his message. We also know from Huberband that he attracted a wide variety of Jews. This were not by any means strictly Hasidic Jews of the Piaseczno variety. There were, you know, non-believing Jews, secular Jews, Jews of every political stripe that came to look for religious guidance from this man. And even though he had received, you know, requests from the resistance to spirit him away out of the ghetto, he refused. And he saw that his purpose was to remain with the Jews in the ghetto, and as a result, you know, he ultimately served them to the bitter end. One other detail perhaps it's the most central thing. You know, you may be wondering, well, what did he say about the Holocaust as a whole? I mean, this is what he's writing about for 3 years. So when you go through the Esh Kodesh, you see that there's at no point where the Jews suddenly have a flash, like, oh my gosh, this is the Holocaust. Obviously, the term had not yet been invented. It was kind of like a gradual but perpetual increasing level of persecution, worse every day, but only in an incremental level. So at some point, people would wake up and say, I can't understand what is happening at all on a religious level, personal level, and so on. So we see only one spot in the Esh Kodesh where he kind of steps over that line. And that's in a footnote that he added in January of 1943, shortly before he buried the manuscripts. Recall that in January of 1943, this is after the Warsaw Ghetto has been largely decimated, or I shouldn't say decimated, has been destroyed by the deportation. He comments on something that he wrote in 1940. In 1940, when he was talking about Hanukkah, He said, you know, it's terrible how we're suffering now, but really, when you look at the story of the Jews in Israel during the period of Antiochus, in which we had the Hanukkah rebellion, we see that, you know, this is a pattern, this happens to us from time to time, and we should deal with it and, you know, strengthen our spines and just move on. Then he writes in the footnote in 1943, he says, I was wrong. He says, what I wrote in 1940, I could only have written then. But after what I've seen in 1941 and 1942, comparing it with my knowledge of all of Jewish history from the Talmud and the Midrash and so on, I can say, he writes, that there's never been a level of suffering in all of Jewish history that compares with what we are enduring in the Holocaust. He obviously doesn't use that term, but he says, there's nothing like this. This is a novum. It is totally unprecedented. Question.
One of the things that, when I was growing up learning about the Holocaust, you get an idea that Hitler, from day one, wanted to kill all of the Jews. And I think reading history, you see that there were turning points in the war. Mm-hmm. I think they invaded Russia in June of 41. They thought that was going to be very easy. 2 or 3 months, and we'll be finished. And I think in October, they started realizing that
was not going to happen.
I think they were afraid of American intervention during the war. Mm-hmm. And fear of that, I think, prevented them from killing the Jews. That ended December 8th, 1941, when Hitler declared war. A lot of historians place the decision to exterminate at December 18th, 1941. So if the Germans didn't know they were going to kill all the Jews, there's no way the Jews would have known.
Absolutely.
All of the Jews. And so it's the Germans are gradually coming to that decision that this is how we're going to handle this. We're not going to deport them west of the Urals, because the west of the east of the Urals doesn't exist. So, you know, it's something I think that is developing over time because of historical circumstances.
Absolutely.
This doesn't excuse anything the Nazis did. But
no, it's just about the mental recognition of what is going on. Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. You're describing the older historical school known as the intentionalists, who argue that it was a conspiracy right from the very beginning, to the more modern school that argues a functionalist model, says that, you know, it sort of evolved as a result of the events of the war, a function of the war. The ghetto also was rife with rumors. I mean, there would be like rumors that would sweep through, like, you know, America has invaded and has conquered all of France, and that would be like a year before they actually land on the shores. And Jews would have like moments of a euphoria that would last a day or two, and then they would find out, no, we were wrong, and they would sink into depression. And because they had very few sources of reliable news in the ghetto, and it was just word of mouth, and you know how Jews can be with word of mouth. It's not necessarily a good thing. But let me move back to where we are right now, because we have to talk about the Rebbe's personal tragedy and then a little bit about his legacy in this context. The drushes are extremely moving and powerful, and I strongly urge you to consider reading them, although it's kind of dark reading in many ways. They're informed by his own personal association with tragedy. As I mentioned, his wife passed away in 1938, and he was survived by a son, a daughter-in-law, and another daughter. And I believe he had another daughter as well. I think it was 3 children, if I remember correctly. But in the context of the immediate bombing right after September 1st, 1939, it was on the holiday of, actually it was just a little before the holiday of Sukkot, when a bomb fragment went through the window of their apartment and struck his son, fatally as it turned out. They rushed him to the hospital, which was overwhelmed with civilian casualties, and it was very difficult for them to get treatment for him. As the father was running around trying to find a doctor to help his wounded son, his sister and his daughter-in-law stood outside the overcrowded hospital saying Tehillim, reciting Psalms. And at that point, another bomb actually fell directly outside the hospital and killed the sister and the surviving wife of his son, his daughter-in-law. A couple days later, with no significant medical treatment, he had to take his son back home, where he expired a couple days later in the holiday of Sukkot. So within a very short period of time, the Piaseczno Rebbe loses almost all of his family and is completely devastated. There is a period of several weeks where he does not write. We can only assume that he didn't give a Shalosh Shuddos Drasha, and then he returns with an incredibly powerful passage on the Parsha of Chaye Sarah, which describes the death of Sarah. And this is something that I have to describe to you in brief. The Midrash records that the matriarch Sarah died when the Satan, came to her and said, "Do you know what your husband is doing? He's about to sacrifice Isaac on Har HaMoriah," or he had sacrificed him, I'm not sure what he told him. And the Midrash says that her soul burst forth and she died. You know, hearing the shock of what was happening to her son, she died. So the Rebbe quotes a Midrash that says that, amazingly, she did this intentionally. That, you know, this was a kind of a message that this is too much. And he quotes in this context the Hasidic teaching of Rabbi Menachem Mendel of Rimanov that says that in the Talmud it teaches that, you know, a little bit of salt improves meat. You have a little bit of salt on your meat, it tastes much better. Too much salt ruins the meat entirely. And so too with suffering. A little bit of suffering for a person, that's good for character. You know what suffering is, you know how to overcome it, you can identify this. It's good for you to suffer a little bit. But too much suffering can break a person. And so too, he leaves us to connect the dots. He says to God, as it were, too much suffering will break us. Just as Sarah, as a kind of a protest, gave her life up to indicate that, so too, God, perhaps too much suffering is too much for us. It's a very powerful voice of protest, as it were, coming from a traditional Hasidic author, and it gives you a sense of the depth of his suffering. However, in the fall of 1940, the suffering the Jews endured then was nothing compared to what would come in the next 2 years. So, to kind of conclude by thinking about his life and work and his legacy, you know, his principal teachings throughout, and these are themes which we see in his earlier works and we see them also in Esh Kodesh, is the importance of simcha, the importance of happiness nevertheless, the importance of simcha, of joy throughout, even under incredibly difficult circumstances. He also emphasized the power of the moment, the power of making the right choice when the opportunities are presented. And I wish I had more time to give you more examples of this. But his teachings endure before the Esh Kodesh were ever even written. He was ultimately deported to the Travniki labor camp. As I mentioned earlier, he survived the deportation. We don't know what role he had in the resistance, but he survived the resistance as well, and the tremendous, you know, the emptying of the ghetto that happened after the Warsaw Uprising. And ultimately, he was deported sometime in the late summer of 1943 to a labor camp called Travniki. We have a couple of testimonies about what he was like in Travniki by survivors of that labor camp who indicate that, you know, he continued to minister to the slave population there as well, and then he was killed by the Nazis, most likely in an attempted uprising in that camp as well. His legacy lives on, however, his most significantly through his teachings, which, as I have mentioned, have been translated and are studied more now than perhaps they were even in the 1930s. This is a copy of a recent translation in two volumes of The Obligation of Students, and we anticipate that his other books will also be rendered into English as well. There's a very significant synagogue in Woodmere called the Congregation Esh Kodesh, named after the Piaseczno Rebbe because of his very powerful teachings, led by Rabbi Moshe Weinberger, a very charismatic an influential rabbi at Yeshiva University. So all told, this is a person who really, you know, was on a trajectory of excellence before the war, and even though he was placed under tremendously difficult circumstances by the Nazi occupation, he nevertheless rose to the challenge of ministering to his beleaguered population of Jews. And may Hashem avenge his blood, and may we know no more pain such as this.
Amen.
Thank you very much for your attention. Next week we'll speak about Rav Soloveitchik from Yeshiva University, very important American Jewish thinker. Thank you. Okay.